Today's class will have two things to tell you. One thing is, in the last class we observed how cryptography is important no matter what. Tomorrow, if it's a very secure place where we all know that nobody is going to steal anything, who was the one who sent me a link on this village where doors are kept open all the time? That is a really, really, really interesting link. You probably should have posted it on cryptology.
I think googlenews.com.
Did you post it there?
No.
No, please do that. So whenever you encounter a nice new link, make it a habit to post it on the Google group. All right? Okay, good. So now, we're going to look at two things today. And if you probably want to term one of the classes as the most important class, it would be this throughout the semester. Right? Because two very interesting topics. See, it is not the subject that makes a person write textbooks this thick. Right? It is not as a matter of compulsion that people write books this thick. People write books because they are inspired by some one problem. Trust me, the reason why I am today a PhD and I'm teaching you people is because some one problem somewhere down the lane interested me. And some professor gave me that problem and I worked on it and I got a career out of it. Alright, so these problems could be something that can make you probably a cryptologist tomorrow, or a computer scientist tomorrow, or a big time researcher tomorrow. Okay, to quote a couple of my own students, I even asked them, I had a student of mine, she was an electrical student, electronics EC student. Okay, I asked her, she is now a cryptologist in University of California, Los Angeles. I asked her, what took you to UCLA, Vani, while you were actually an EC student? She claims that whatever I taught her, I'm not taking self-credit here, I'm just giving you an example, said that this particular concept that you taught made me so enthralled that I studied the entire subject, and I studied the subject and responsible for wanting to understand this subject, and I thought if I enjoy so much reading it, why not make a career out of it? Right? And
a painter, probably, he makes money out of painting, at the same time, he's passionate about painting. Right. Similarly, this could be walkway for you to probably make your career, if not in cryptography, at least in computer science, or maybe in sciences, you never know. Alright, so let's look at this one problem, which I'm going to explain with an example. Alright,
it's a very, what is that, instead of using a example across LOC, given that my videos are recorded, I'm not so sure whether it's ethical, but let's go ahead, let me paint your tape, big deal. Okay, so assume there's a Punjabi dawa near the LOC, where they make extremely delicious parathas, okay? And you as a computer scientist, you're sitting in Mufti,
big deal.
Computer scientist is always in the Mufti, right? I mean, you wear civil, you don't wear any uniform, alright? You are sitting there as a common citizen, right? Trying to see who visits this dawa, alright? You're sitting there for a reason. The reason follows from the data, right? All of you imagine you are sitting there alone. You're an intelligence officer from India, alright? By the way, intelligence officers are not officers who are intelligent. That's a name given to a profession, right? Fine. You're sitting there, and supposedly this happens. There's a soldier across LOC who finds parathas here very delicious.
Alright? He somehow seeks permission there along the border and enters the border, has paratha.
And goes up.
Alright? People permit that for whatsoever
reasons. Alright?
People permit that. Our army permits it. Alright? And you know some data. The data is that
every Pakistani soldier
with a uniform.
And the uniform is numbered.
Right? This is a protocol you have learned long back. It is a convention in, let's say, Pakistani army to write number 1, number 2, number 3, up to number N.
If they have N number of people, you have
1, 2, 3, up to N on their shirts. Right?
A Pakistani soldier comes, he has some I written on it, he runs and he has paratha and then goes back.
Some J comes,
goes back. A1, A2, A3, A4, AK comes
and goes back.
You have seen K people coming and having paratha
in that daba.
Are you an intelligence officer sitting in the corner?
Right? And observe these K numbers.
Now, do you know something?
Pakistan has
spent 56% of its economy
on defense. 56 is, oh
my god, 56%.
Right?
And it's estimated that they have 60+ billion US dollars
debt. And it takes
a lifetime of every single citizen of Pakistan today to work and get that loan
off their country.
Right?
It's so much of debt on their head. That's because all that
they have been concentrating are
on the army forces,
air forces,
and going nuclear.
Right? Now, it is important for two people when they fight,
when they get their armies up, they must know
how weak or how strong is the opponent's army.
Right? How many, if
it's a, you hear, let's say, a naval officer, you must know how many fighting ships are there on the other side,
how many fighting
aircrafts are there on the other side,
so that you can accordingly have a little more and win.
Winning is all about dominating,
at least in numbers.
You cannot evaluate the skills of individual soldiers, but you can at least look at the aircrafts, right?
Assume you have,
you have to enter a Kabaddi tournament.
Kabaddi tournament where the number of
team players is customizable.
If I have two, you have
10, obviously we will lose. Alright? Assuming all of us are equally strong.
We should understand
how many team players are going to be there and have accordingly here.
Alright? To
assuming that every person costs a few dollars.
Now,
you are there sitting, looking at people coming and going.
You are there
to estimate the number of army men in Pakistan. Get the point? You are sitting there for that reason.
You observe everyone coming, eating and going. You know what data. That data is accurate.
It's truth.
The data is that
every person has a number
written on him. And Pakistan soldiers are numbered from
1 to N. Your job is to find
M.
You don't get to go there and see everybody.
You only get to see K of them.
You get to see K of them coming and having paratas and then going.
Random K people, some K people.
Now you are asked
to predict M.
Do you have enough
information to predict M?
You know this CAT question, right? Data insufficient. D.
A 6, B is 12, C 23, D data insufficient.
What is your answer? You think
it is doable A?
B it's not a doable project. C data is insufficient and hence you don't
want to take such. Doable? Okay.
I'll give you the numbers, all right? You as a computer scientist,
can you tell me what is N?
For example,
let's get back to computer science right now, all right? You look at the data there,
where? In the
border,
and come back home.
You have A1, A2, up to AK.
You must predict N.
What will be your program?
What will you write? Or in other words, let's simulate this.
There's a random number generator
which generates number from 1 to N. I give you that function, I'll not tell you what is N.
But the point? I'll give you that function, but I'll not tell you what is N.
Alright? You can tap it to spit out
the random numbers
a few times, maybe
10 times.
But with that, you must extrapolate and tell me
what is N. Can you do that? Come on, it's a be patriotic. I mean,
it's a dual
situation. You're recruited to predict the number of army men in Pakistan.
Look, your prediction can mean a lot for
India, you know. If you randomly simply predict, I think it should be some 1 lakh.
Okay, let's do one thing. I think I should
write here. Let me, I haven't used this.
Let me try. All right,
so look at this.
Assuming you're in the border,
all right, both of you
are sitting in the border, and you
observe that the number 17th
person comes there, number 17
inscribed on his shirt,
all right, and then you have 276, and then 16, and then
431.
Okay. So 431, and 64, and 183. That's all. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,
6 people come and have paratha.
Sir, we can take an average of it and decide that which number, if you take the probability.
Wait. I am not asking you for conceptual details.
This is what you.
Can you all predict how many people are there in the border? I mean, in Pakistan. How many of you think it's data insufficient? Okay,
so I am the army general.
right? I have sent you, I have recruited you, I am the Army General. I ask you to go and get back to me. I've invested money on you, right? Would you say data insufficient or would you like to take a chance? At least you know that there are greater than
431 soldiers.
Would you have an army comprising of 431 soldiers to fight them?
Yes?
What if it's 500?
They outpower you by 70. Let's have a safe
bet. Let's have 2,000.
Sensible.
2,000 would involve a lot of cost.
Right?
You might run out of resources.
They will attack you over air finally.
And you will not have enough money to fight them back.
So the idea is to optimize the resources.
How many
army men will you produce?
Quick.
It's not a bidding
mechanism.
500 ones?
500 two times? Thrice?
Alright.
Quick. Any input? No, 500 you must tell me why.
You think so?
What is bit of probability? I heard of probability.
What is bit of probability?
Sir, come on, people, 11.
Some guess.
You know what?
What I'm quoting is a very well-known
problem.
I think the history of the problem,
which I, by the way, did the last time I had in the class. I'm sure most of the seniors were in there then.
Just me an answer for this question.
Some answer. Tell me, all of you take a chance. 500, 1,000.
700.
1,500.
1,500.
786. Sir, tell me your total marks in 12th standard.
Go on. 786.
Write down your numbers.
Maybe I had the average difference to the largest number.
Number?
They have to calculate.
Calculate it into the number. Let me see who wins.
I did the exact answer.
How many Arabians are there in Pakistan?
And I'll use my way of handling it.
Write your numbers quickly. All of you done?
Done. All of you write your answers. Now look at my way of arguing. All right?
I do the following. Let the army men be n in number.
Alright? 1 up to
n. Can you see?
Yeah, 1 up to n. 1, 2, 3, 4
up to n. Alright? You saw a 17.
You saw a 17. You saw a 276, let's say it's here. 16, which is right here, etc., etc. Okay? Alright? This is how you saw.
Now look at this. From 1 to n, I don't know what is n here. I need to find what is n.
If you are asked to pick
two numbers.
Get the intuition right.
If you're asked to pick two numbers,
mostly one number will be here, one number will be here.
Note the usage of the word mostly.
Okay, it is a little less likely
for both the numbers to be here.
Right?
More likely for one number to be here, one number to here. What is the probability?
1/2. That one number is here and one number is here.
The probability that both are here is 1/4. Both are here is 1/4.
1/2 is a more likely event.
Alright?
You can say that
one is here.
Alright? Look, data insufficient.
Actually, what's your name?
Shashank's answer is in fact the right answer. But we are
asked to take a rough guess.
Any rough guess approximation seems to be better than simply, you know,
closing your eyes and
asking God.
But that's different.
So
do that also and try to do this as well.
Alright? So look at this. Look at
my analysis. In the next 5 minutes, you'll know the answer.
Alright? Let's see who comes
first. Who comes
close to my answer?
1 to n, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 numbers, correct? 6 numbers.
With a very
high probability, if I classify this into
6 sectors, 1, 2,
3, 4, 5, 6.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Excuse me.
Means not equally,
right? Equally spaced.
Right?
Each of these numbers should probably
fall in one of these sectors. Correct? Yes or no?
Into one of these sectors.
Correct?
I'll do one thing.
I'll classify them into, let's say, 7 sectors. 6 and 7. 7.
Each number will fall here. The maximum number will be here.
Correct? You take only 7 samples.
7 samples should be uniformly distributed.
Maximum will be here.
Maximum will be here.
What you should
compute is this.
Alright?
correct? Maximum is here. Maximum is not the number. Well, there's a little more than maximum, definitely.
What is that little more? It is going to be m plus m
by
7.
Agree?
M plus
m by 7. So what is that? M is here 431
plus
431 by 7. Actually, it's there's
minus 7
by 7, but that's okay. 6 or 7, that's okay. That's not a big deal. Okay, what is this roughly?
What is this roughly?
7, 5, 35, 7, 6, 42, 60.
Let's say 60.
Sir, I told you 500. Gaurav. You have a fantastic intuition, but I think you just got lucky in this case, right?
So 491
seems to be
the right number. Do you all, isn't this better than any of the rough guesses that you can possibly take?
What is your refutation now? How do you know it's
uniformly distributed?
I don't know it's uniformly distributed.
But mostly I guess, very likely that it's uniformly distributed. You toss a coin 100 times. Will you bet?
It's a fail coin. Will you bet that I have got 10 heads and 90 tails? No. You can bet that I have
got 50 plus or minus 5 heads and the rest tails.
That's a fail bet. Plus or minus 5, you are giving me a neighborhood. You probably will even win. Correct? I'm doing something like that.
Now, this is time tested.
During Second World War, okay, the Western Allies wanted to predict how many German tanks were there.
Fighter tanks. Alright? You know what
they did? They recruited intelligence bureau, right? And after they thought, let's also recruit some statistician
who seems to
know how to calculate, how to add, subtract, multiply, divide. Maybe they may also be of some help.
Alright?
They recruited statisticians. They recruited intelligence bureau. Alright?
Intelligence bureau people said,
I think roughly it is 1,100 tanks. You know what they did? They go around, sneak around, you know, get into the territory, sometimes even get killed, count the number of tanks in a place, run back
and then say, this is what I think is a number. Alright?
Plain empirical observatory, observable evidence. Statisticians, you know what they did?
They asked,
have you captured any of the tanks so far?
Yes, we have
captured some tanks.
We would like to take a look at the tank.
They showed the tanks.
So these statisticians.
They look in the tires of the tanks. They observed that the tires were
numbered. This is the Pakistani example.
The tires were numbered. 1, 2, 3 up to N, whatever was the number of tanks, it was numbered.
They saw these random K numbers and used this formula and said, your intelligence bureau predicted 1,100,
but our statistics
says it should not be more than 250.
Okay? These people did not hear, listen to them. They said, okay, fine, I think
the intelligence bureau should be intelligent in their statisticians. Let's go by them.
Alright?
They manufactured 1,000
tanks.
And finally, when they captured, they realized the number of tanks were 267.
This not just happened.
This time, thrice.
Three full times. And you know what?
Till date, this problem is popular because it occurs in different contexts.
Alright? You stand and you sample something and you must predict
what is inside
by looking at
sampling. Okay?
Concluding globally
by looking locally is a very, very famous problem which occurs in different aspects of computing and even electronics.
Right? By looking
at the traffic, you must predict what is the traffic in general.
Right? How much should you see and how much can you
predict? How precisely can you predict? Okay?
Please make a note of this.
This is called the German tank problem. Alright? Take a look at the Wikipedia entry. I'm sure you will
like the story there.
Alright? One thing.
Second thing. Do you have a much more intelligent way of predicting the Pakistani
army man's strength?
Which can
better this conceptually. Conceptually, does anyone here have
any remark to shoot for what I did? Isn't it better than any
one of your rough guesses?
Definitely, you all agree with me, right?
You all agree with me?
I have a question for you all.
Can you better this conception?
Can you say, I think,
Sudarshan, you are
being a little less accurate.
I think I can better this.
Conceptually, mine is
much better than yours. Can you do something like that?
No?
The
only data you have is
just these numbers.
just these numbers, nothing else but this.
17, 276, 16, 431, 64,
183. That's all.
Period, nothing else.
Any idea? You can better this phenomenally.
Maybe we can use Lagrange method in order to find the next element.
Lagrange interpolation is
a very, very, very conceptually different method.
You know what it does?
It looks at the data,
says for one it is
so much, two it is
so much, three it is
so much, etc., etc. Right? And then they write a
polynomial which goes through all these points. Give me any bunch of points, I can always give you a polynomial
that goes through these points.
Right? Roughly, you give me k points, I can give you a polynomial of degree k plus 1 or k, I don't remember, roughly that k. Which goes through all these points. Then you say, any other point should also be on this curve. That's like taking a guess.
Here, there's no except
very well. It's only one dimension.
Right? There are only some values on the real line. Okay? Wise thing to do is take the maximum number and have a little more than that. What is that little more? I have given you one method. Can you give me another method? Right?
We can take average and two times average will be maximum.
Correct. So you're giving me a mechanism. Okay, I gave you
a mechanism. Do you have any other mechanism?
So,
you're going to give me one mechanism. You're going to give me another mechanism. You're going to give me another mechanism. We have five mechanisms. I'll invite Manisha to
investigate
on which mechanism is better. We only tell her
the algorithms. We don't
tell her any
data.
We only tell her the algorithms. How will she evaluate it?
How will she evaluate it? Computer science students, this is
a straightforward way of evaluating this.
Write a program, generate a random number,
hide n, take some sampling,
and try predicting according to you, according to me, according to him, according to him. And see how many times who is the closest.
That's all. Period. That's a fantastic observation.
Correct? Alright. Did you all get what I said?
Right. Now.
See, there's
there's a problem if
these army men
are coming from one
sector.
There's a problem if the
name convention is different altogether.
There are some assumptions
we are making here. Assumption is that there are
n numbers.
All of them are assigned that way. All of them are aligned. If they only give them even numbering,
oh my god.
You are dead.
Correct? You will be overshooting
by twice.
Get the point? All these numbers
are, let's say, even. Right? They are numbered
only even.
Or let's say, hotel rooms.
So there will be 101, 102. We've covered the power there are 102 rooms here. First floor will be 101.
102, 103. Second floor will be 201, 202, 203.
Okay.
Interestingly, in
the US,
if you take a lift,
there will not be a 13th floor there.
Right? 1, 2, 3,
11, and then 14.
Direct jump. Can you guess why?
That's all.
It's a bad number. It's
a lucky number. Similarly, you know, for convention, for
clarity's sake, they'll have 101, 102 for first floor, second floor will be
201, 203. You
take some random room numbers and you will predict that there are around 400 rooms in this place.
You see, that spacing is really required.
It's an assumption
that a cryptographer first looks at.
Alright?
Based on the assumption, assuming that the assumption is true,
right? He goes ahead and he
predicts. Alright? We will see yet another
historically very significant and
mind-blowing incident that happened
during
the Civil War of the
Confederate States of America.
There's a bunch of people who,
I think
you know the history of America, you know what I'm talking
about. But nevertheless, you need not
worry about that.
Heard of Lewis Carroll?
Lewis Carroll.
Okay, you call it Lewis
Carroll. Okay, fine. Lewis Carroll.
Alice in Wonderland fame.
Correct.
He was not just a writer, he was
also a mathematician. He was also a puzzle creator. He used to create a lot of word games.
Right? Every Christmas
he used to release a word game.
He was a proponent of a kind of cipher, which
I'm going to discuss right now, which we discussed in the last class.
He said this is just
unbreakable. No one can break this. And this CSA people were trying to use it day in and day in and day out, and they never
knew that the other
person had broken it long back.
Alright? Happily, it's like
me and you exchange information.
Your emails are tapped, someone is reading
your emails, and you have no clue about it.
For the next 10 years, he'll be reading your emails. A similar thing happened here.
Alright? It will be totally useless if he looks at your email or my email, but definitely, emails exchange between two countries is of great importance.
Right? Okay, what happened?
Right?
Let's get back to our cryptography basics in the previous class. Okay? Do you
remember what I said? There are a bunch of people sitting here. A company this side, a company that side.
Right? They need to talk to these people. The problem here is very straightforward.
You encrypt something and then send. She encrypts something and then sends to you. All of your proper mechanism. Someone here told me that we can have a key and then encrypt and then send and then decrypt, etc., etc. Right? Whatever mechanism you use.
Right? If one person leaves the place, the entire thing is leaked. Correct?
Entire thing is leaked.
For example, let's say
Manisha from here leaves the company. She might as well join some other malicious company tomorrow who wants to know what is happening between these two companies.
These two countries.
Right? So
they all will panic once she leaves.
A nice mechanism would be to have a key-like thing
where you just change the key, not the algorithm.
And you assume
that algorithm, and you should not worry, you should not keep the algorithm secret.
Algorithm should be known for everybody.
Right? Someone suggested,
I think you suggested the last time,
that you have a substitution cipher.
You take
A, B, C, D, E, F, G up to Z. A for B for some
K, or and B for some D, so that it's not in sequence. Right? And some random, there are so many alphabets in Devanagari Lipi, and you can just assign them to A, B, C, D, and you're done.
I mean, it's very hard to pick.
Correct? So we think. But you know something? If you take
Shakespeare's
Othello, if you take this A, B, C, D in x-axis and draw the number of occurrences of A in y-axis, E will be ranked first.
Always.
If it's sufficiently big.
I told you,
Sudarshan, there is no E at all.
Correct? But if it's sufficiently big,
and if it's proper English,
you will have E having an upper hand.
Next will be T. Next will be A.
Next will be O. This proper ranking is always obeyed if it goes beyond a few pages. Shakespeare's Othello
is roughly? Or let's say Alice in Wonderland. You people said
Alice in Wonderland.
Alice in Wonderland.
Roughly some 30 pages. Alright? You take that, you'll see that E will be the most frequently occurring letter.
What you do is, in case Alice in Wonderland is encrypted, go ahead. Look at the most frequently occurring symbol
there. Put E on top of it. One letter decrypted. Done.
Next. Next most frequently occurring letter will obviously be
D. Next most will be O. Next most will be A.
Next, I think.
Yes, if I'm not right.
So you have a table which you can
empirically observe and write down.
Take some other novel. See the most frequently occurring letters there.
Give the ranking. The same ranking should be
obeyed here also. There also, but language, linguistic signatures. So we can only info only first few letters, because after that the frequency is so similar that we cannot do.
Absolutely not. If you take Alice in Wonderland, let's say if you take
Da Vinci Code,
alright? Da Vinci Code is one book that I have, I used to search for words
in files. Alright? Whatever words I used to search in my hard disk, it used to take me to Da Vinci Code book.
It seems it has
the entire vocabulary in it. Alright? So if it's sufficiently big, sufficiently is not some more than 20-30 pages, it should be beautifully open.
It will be, it's
a property of English language.
In fact, more surprising thing is ahead for you.
Right? If you don't believe this, you probably will never believe that.
Right? So, do one thing. Project Gutenberg.
Heard of it? Go there. Download a text.
Download a novel.
Three Musketeers
or whatever. The whole of Charles Dickens is there. The whole of Shakespeare is there.
Right?
It may not be Elizabethan English, but modern English. Download that. Write a quick half a page Python script to look at the distribution. Right? And
rank, don't look at the frequency.
Look at the frequency and then rank the words.
Which is the first rank,
is the second rank,
third rank, fourth rank.
For all these novels, ranking will agree. All these novels.
You should not take a
poem,
a sonnet. Alright? You should take a reasonably big novel.
This will be respected. Or, it shows up.
Big thing, substitution cipher is broken. Correct? This is something many people
came out with.
A bit of observation will tell you this. But what
came as an improvement for this cipher was hard to break.
So
did Libby Carroll think. Alright? He said, the people said the following. Okay? If this is hard to break, we will
stick to the following mechanism.
Okay? This is called the Wigner cipher. Though Wigner made it very popular historically, there were people who were using it in 17th century. Okay? So, you have a text.
All right?
Let me try use some abstraction. I hope all of you are.
Okay? Text with
P1 being a letter,
P2 being a letter,
plain text.
All right? Assume I have
P10,000
lettered
letter.
All right?
What I do is I take a name.
Okay? Let's say
Abhimanyu.
That's my password.
All right?
What I do is I write. Right. I write
Abhimanyu.
Look, this is my password. Right? I write Abhimanyu.
I shift P1 by
A letters. I shift it by A letters.
A is what? 1.
Correct?
Which means P1 becomes,
in case this was some S, this becomes T. If this was some S-O,
S-O-U-G-H-T, O becomes,
B is what? 2. O-P-Q. Right? U becomes, H is what? A, B, C, D, E, F,
G, H. 8.
Okay?
Shift U by 8.
V, W, X, Y, Z, A, B, C. You must always look at. Right? Becomes C. G,
according to I, becomes G,
H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P.
P. You got the idea, right? Do it for Abhimanyu
until here. And then repeat Abhimanyu.
Repeat Abhimanyu.